There was an event back in October, and it was after Treaty Day, because of course we were very conscious of the purpose of Treaty Day and to bring it to the public's attention. But what often gets neglected in the Treaty Day process is that everyone's conception is that Treaty Day is just an Indigenous issue. And a number of us got together because we wanted to break that rigid definition and open up a discussion. Not necessarily everyone agreeing, but putting all the information on the table and then have a discussion about what not only what the treaty meant, but what the relationship of non-Indigenous people are to those treaties and to what they mean. What was so good about that gathering was that it brought everybody together, and it was a good showing, an excellent bunch of people. And each of the speakers brought to it their own perspective. Ben, as a teacher, brought forward, a little bit of the history, and he spoke of history not just being what was and just as someone else defines history, but from the viewpoint of everybody concerned, so that you get an anti-colonial viewpoint of history. And he did an excellent job on that, and he did it as a non-Indigenous person in a very fair way. And then others spoke, like Naomi spoke about the legal end of things and all the battles that had happened, and especially the way that she spoke to let us help each other, which is so important to resolving these issues. And each person had a different, the Black community of Fua Cooper, where she spoke of where Black people don't quite fit into the settler, colonist paradigm. It was a pretty heated discussion at some point at the end because we ran short of time. I think if people went back, and hopefully as they will, and look at what was said, and then not get caught up in the individual words or the nuances of what was said, but the underlying message of every single person. When I looked at it after being in attendance there and looked at the whole thing, I was struck by not only the distinctiveness of what each person had to contribute, but especially the underlying unity from what everyone said. And the message couldn't be more loud and clear. And it's also a message of one of the recommendations of the TRC to get this education into every educational institution, and for us to sit down and start talking to each other, and more importantly, to listen to each other. And that applies to both sides, to listen respectfully and see also, as Sherry emphasized, that this is about the land, and to listen to each other and support each other around the land, because that's the underlying principle. And we're looking today at Paris and the Indigenous Environmental Network over there trying to bring the issues to climate justice. And this is part of the treaty process. And so if people stop for a moment and think before they speak, then all of this will fall in place. And to me, that's the real value of this. And hopefully we can have another gathering, maybe tying all these things together about what is everybody's role in climate justice, in the land, and in the treaties, because they're all related. And that in the final phase is what it's all about, is about the relationships, the treaty relations, the relations we have with each other. And that, to me, that's what matters. We never, ever ceded that land. Never. So Nova Scotia Mi'kma'ki is still Mi'kma'ki, and there's no getting around that. And that's where the powers that be, the colonial powers, dig their heels in, because they refuse to recognize that, just as they refuse to recognize it in the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that's a fundamental question. And that's the question today. How do we get along? How can we get along with each other in a respectful way, recognizing each person, each peoples, you know, separately, but without giving up our own ways of seeing?
Okay.
had a little bit of confusion about times here, and on your programs it says Elder Billy Lewis was to do an opening. I know he's on his way here. We may hear from him later in the evening. Kevin, in the meantime, Kevin Christmas is so graciously has offered to step in. Kevin Christmas is from Member 2 in Cape Breton, and I've known Kevin, I hate to say it, Kevin, all of my life, which cast him in that elder too. Yeah, and he was very instrumental in helping the chiefs, I think, putting together the first Aboriginal position paper back in the early 1970s, and he's been an activist and a fighter for Aboriginal and Indigenous rights, and particularly Mi'kmaq treaty rights, for as long as I've known him. And so I'd like to welcome Kevin Christmas to say it all. Thank you.
Thank you. And I met with the mayor a couple weeks ago, and all we talked about was treaty. And I was telling him that Halifax is the only city in the Commonwealth that was created by treaty. And it's the only city, actually, that has inspired our people to come here and complain to you every year. It's a nice place to complain. I started this work a long time ago, and I've grown to be an elder of sorts in our community. But I started this when I was very young, and I was amazed at the rich history, hundreds of thousands of pieces of evidence, just incredible stories of fortitude and resilience and brilliance. And when you look at the words of the treaty, and you try to ignore the English, the Mi'kmaq translation of the French is exquisite. I mean, even a phrase that's used in the treaty, interior liberty, it's French. And you have to keep it in French because there's no English words for complete, absolute freedom. That concept doesn't seem to exist in English. But you ask any French person, what does interior liberty mean? And you'll start a war, I'll guarantee you. But for over 40 years, I've become very intimate with these materials and this information. And you know what? This is the first time in all my life that I was asked to speak about this. And I've written thousands and thousands of articles and opinions, but this is the first time I actually spoke about it. And the only thing that really drew me here, I drove up here because I wanted to hear what Sherry had to say. I like Sherry. But when I read the theme, "We Are All Treaty," oh my God, I wanted to get angry. But then I said, no, maybe this is a time to not fall into that political correctness. We may be all treaty, but we're not all original. We're original. We named all the rivers. We named all the trees. We worked it out with Creator directly. We followed his instructions. We fulfilled our end of the prophecies, the promises. We did our part. And when 64 very sickly French men showed up in Annapolis, there were no French women. So 64 French men married 64 Mi'kmaq women. And they all had an average of 18 children each.
Right on.
Assimilation right away. None of this setting up French territory crap. No, no, you move into the house. You're part of the family. Because the French had those beautiful words that expressed their, I don't know, their worldliness, their maturity, their sophistication. I guess I'm kind of biased. But that was a real golden era for our people because they learned and discovered so many new things. We knew that at that point it was the... You see why they never asked me to talk about this. There was a fulfillment of a prophecy that was held a long time before the actual arrival. See, the arrival was a fulfillment. And they said that there would be a seven-week generation deterioration to this time. And we would come to this point in our history where all of this stuff had to be talked about. And we've studied a long time so we can talk intelligently about it with you. And we hope you guys will be able to talk to us intelligently about it too. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think one of the things that we want to do tonight is to explain the pieces of fabric that are sitting on the floor. And where's Aiden Gillis? Could you stand up, Aiden? Aiden is a student at the College of Art and Design, and we wanted to make a small symbolic gesture for people to think of throughout the evening. The piece of fabric on the right shows the proportion of reserve land in all of Canada compared to the size of this entire room. And the piece of fabric on the left shows the proportion of reserve land in Nova Scotia proportionate to the entire province of Nova Scotia. So we've placed these here asking that people will think about it tonight. Dalhousie, bienvenue, welcome to everyone here. Tonight's event entitled Between Nations, We Are All Treaty People. My name is Jackie Barkley, and I'm a member of Solidarity Halifax, one of the host organizations of this event held on unceded Mi'kmaq territory. All of us in Jibuktuk, Halifax, are standing or sitting, reading, talking, living, and going about our daily routines on unceded Mi'kmaq territory. But what does that actually mean? And what does it mean for whom? And what do we do about it? Definitive answers to these questions are not easy to find, but the need and in fact the responsibility to seriously address and consider these questions is what has motivated this event tonight. It is our intent to look at what it means for all of us, distinctly and collectively, to live where treaties outlining access to the land and its resources have been drafted and signed long before us. Here in Nova Scotia and throughout Mi'kmaq, it is the Peace and Friendship Treaties that outline the territorial rights and obligations of Indigenous nations and of the Canadian state. These treaties were the first to be signed and recognized by the British Crown and set the stage for all future agreements between Indigenous nations and the British, later Canada, on this continent. Interestingly, the province of Nova Scotia is the only Canadian province to recognize Treaty Day on October 1st of every year to commemorate the Peace and Friendship Treaties. Unfortunately, within the non-native population, there's a general assumption that treaties and Treaty Day are a native thing only, something that doesn't concern those who are non-native. But of course, treaties are agreements between two parties. So whether you are a First Nation person or not, if you live here, the treaties apply to you. We are all of us who live here, treaty people. But with the growing awareness of the existence of the treaties has come also a growing sense of questioning about how to honor those treaties at a personal and societal level. For both Indigenous and non-Indigenous populations, agency over the treaty relationship is extremely limited. Control over how the treaties are interpreted or respected is concentrated almost exclusively in the hands of politicians and bureaucrats of the Canadian state, and to a lesser extent, the governmental bodies within First Nation communities that are sanctioned by the Canadian state through the very restrictive Indian Act. Between Nations tonight is an attempt to examine avenues for people to understand and engage in the shaping of our treaty relationship today by generating a process of reflection accompanied by small and collective actions. We can begin to move away from Canada's Indian Act and move toward a people's treaty relationship that genuinely follows in the spirit of the Peace and Friendship Treaties. That is to say, we can collectively rebuild that all a relationship that all peoples can genuinely feel we belong to and truthfully engage in. However, in doing so, we fully recognize that the responsibility to address the injustice and suffering caused by centuries of broken promises and cultural genocide rests squarely and heavily on the non-native population, most especially those of European settler descent, who continue to benefit economically and politically from the theft of Indigenous land. At Solidarity Halifax, our interest in this discussion and sense of responsibility to act flows from our understanding that capitalism and colonialism go hand in hand. Today's capitalist imperative for perpetual economic growth continues the suppression of indigenous ways of living that have already been severely damaged by centuries of oppression. By fueling a drive for land and resource privatization in the name of profit, capitalism structures our society in such a way that the suppression of differing worldviews and the repression of those who stand in the way of profit gets validated. And so the peace and friendship treaties that recognize Indigenous sovereignty over this land and those who attempt to live by the treaties come in direct contradiction and conflict with the capitalist economic system which underlies Canadian society. If the treaties are to be enacted, capitalism must go and be replaced by economic relationships and structures that give true democratic and collective power to all those concerned. Further to this, the treaties contain an inherent obligation to protect our shared land and its resources for future generations. Already, treaty rights upheld repeatedly in courts have had the ability to stall environmental degradation for profit accumulation on numerous occasions. Support for legal treaty recognition and the collective enactment of those treaty relationships may very well be our only chance to stop the destructive economy as it relentlessly drives us into climate crisis. Fighting for a new democratic economy, fighting for climate justice, and fighting for treaty rights are all part of the same struggle. With recent attention to frontline resistance against resource extraction from First Nations communities, with the revelations and recommendations that have resulted from the Truth and Reconciliation Report, with the intensifying calls for an inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women, all this in the follow-up of the widely spread Idle No More movement, it seems there's no better time to talk about the treaties. But really, when it comes down to it, we're 400 years late. Indigenous peoples have always been aware of the acute need to respect the treaties. As non-Indigenous peoples become increasingly aware of the political obligation we have to do the same, it becomes a moral imperative that we not waste any more time. Imsit Nogoma.
My name is Taylor Paul. I'm a Mi'kmaq woman, an artist, and a metal fabricator. I live in Halifax, Kitchbukduk. I've been here for about 18 years or so, and was born here as well, and came back. My family's been here for quite a few generations, and I guess I'll get back to that. But I would like to mention that we saw the commitment signing on October 1st for Mi'kmaq and Indigenous studies being taught in public school curriculum throughout Nova Scotia at all levels on October 1st. And I'm quite pleased that that's finally happened. I could only think it's about time when this happened. My son had to remind me that it was a monumental moment because all I could think was it's about time. But it's important to him as well. He actually comes home talking about dealing with race issues being Mi'kmaq because he identifies himself as Mi'kmaq, and comes home talking about it because he's proud of it, and kids in his class don't know who Mi'kmaq people are, or they have miseducation about Mi'kmaq people. And it will be really nice when adults are educating these kids instead of my son on the schoolyard, because it does happen. And you know, at every level, thinking about that, I went into my other son's grade one class to give a talk about Mi'kmaq people, Mi'kmaq culture, just a really casual thing, because they didn't have anything in place to do that. And I took my time to go in and bring some things in and talk to them. And three kids in the class, one who was Mi'kmaq, knew who Mi'kmaq people were, which I think says a lot. I think a lot of grade ones are fine with knowing who Mi'kmaq people are as a nation. And I think there's ways that we can educate children at that age, at every age, that we have a shared environment. And I'll skip to when I was in school. I was raised in... I was raised off-reserve. I went through public school, and I didn't hear about Mi'kmaq people or the word Mi'kmaq mentioned until I was in grade 7. And when I was in grade 7, I was like, it's about time. And then it was one chapter partially dedicated to Mi'kmaq and mixed in with French And that was it after about a week and a half or 2 weeks of studying it. So that, I was like, where did I go? Because as a Mi'kmaq child going to school, everything I learned was about British history, French history. So yes, it's about time that this has happened. And you know, now we have a lot of children who are off-reserve children. They're finally going to be represented by adults, not children having to wonder who they are, where they fit, where their history went, and this sort of thing. Back to my family. My family's been here for generations. My great-grandfather owned a garage here in Halifax, and at the time, I never knew this until someone told me, but my grandfather, who I did know, was in auto body mechanics, or auto body repair and mechanics. The relevance of this is that his father had a garage. At the time, no Native people were allowed to will any property to anyone. Everything was subject to the Department of Northern and Indian Affairs. So every will that was written out, every bit was taken by the Department of Northern and Indian Affairs. If you look at the economic crisis that a race is in, and you look back to the history, a lot of people don't know this, but we were not allowed to pass anything down. It could be a wristwatch, it could be anything of value, and it was taken. So my grandfather worked out of his home, he worked for other people, but his father owned a garage downtown Halifax. So I do have quite a history here, and that's why I stay, and that's why I do these things. I don't work in any kind of, you know, I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a historian, but these are things I do need to know as a Mi'kmaq woman, because there is a certain responsibility that I have accepted for myself as a Mi'kmaq woman to represent myself in this world. And there's a certain education that I realized in my adult life that I really needed to have. So as a person, I take the responsibility on myself and come to events like this and read books and, you know, try and talk to people and soak up as much as I can, and give back and speak out. But I guess what I'm getting at is there's a responsibility there that is actually quite a weight. And I remember one point when I was at one of these talks that I go to way back, and it just, I got used to carrying this weight. I got used to it. It was part of what drove me. It was part of who I was. But I had someone who was non-Native come up to me and ask how they could help, ask what they could do. And I was just shocked. I wasn't used to this. This was my weight because I'm a Mi'kmaq woman, and what? And the way that felt, it felt like they took half the load. And that's why I'm so thankful for all of you to be here today, because it is a shared relationship. Thank you. Well, I'll pass it on to someone else now. And thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it. And thank you to the speakers as well. So, Ben Sichel, I'll pass it over to you. Ben teaches high school in Dartmouth. He teaches Indigenous studies and writes on education, labor, racism, and Aboriginal issues. He holds an MED in intercultural education and teaches students of all backgrounds and at the high school level right now, I believe. And he's a member of Solidarity Halifax and quite active. He's been quite helpful in putting this all together, and I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say. Thank you.
Wayne, Linda Louise Ben Sisha, Elgway, Prince Andrew High School, Jabuktuk. being the Juvenile, I don't know if I said that right, but I hope. Before I start, I have to acknowledge some of the people who have taught me most about the things I'm going to talk about. Mi'kmaq scholars like Daniel Paul, Don Julian, Henri Baptiste, and also friends like people who were here at this table, especially Jackie Barkley and Naomi Metallic. Wow. I'm a settler in Mi'kma'ki. I'm not Indigenous. I'm a fourth generation immigrant. And I went through the public school system and learned about Aboriginal people like most people my age and older probably did in school, which is to say as a footnote or as something that only existed in the past. Now I'm a teacher, and I teach a class called Mi'kmaq Studies 10 to students who are mostly like me, non-Indigenous. It's a course that's been in Nova Scotia schools for just over a dozen years as a result of the efforts of Mi'kmaq people to have this included in the curriculum. And it's through teaching this course that I've learned myself and I've taught students about the Peace and Friendship Treaties. So I'm going to tell you a bit about those and how we go about learning about them in school nowadays. So just a note that the fact that I teach this course is cause for a fair bit of reflection. What does it mean for me to be teaching the history of Aboriginal people to non-Aboriginal students? It's a complicated question. On the one hand, many would argue that Indigenous people should be the ones to teach a course like this. On the other hand, we can argue that it's also the responsibility of settlers to teach non-Native folks about our own role in the history of colonialism, and so we have to take responsibility for that as well. All the while privileging Indigenous voices and perspectives. So in order to learn about the treaties, we have to lay a bit of groundwork first. At the beginning of a course, like when I was in school, the students do first learn about pre-colonial history. So traditionally, this is something that's done at the beginning of Canadian history courses in high school. Maybe there's a couple days spent talking about the various groupings of people in what's now considered Canada, the people of the woodlands, people of the plains, and so forth. In the past, there might have been a few details on what kind of homes people lived in, how they transported themselves, what their diet consisted of, all of which is important and relevant information. But it was traditionally presented as a preamble or a prologue to the beginning of real history, the arrival of Europeans to our land, to this land. What was missing, and what more students learn about now, are the kind of things that make a society fully human, which are the kind of things that have traditionally been left out of the narrative. Like the fact that long before Mi'kmaq people started trading with Portuguese and Basque fishermen in the 16th century, there were complex governance structures in place in Mi'kma'ki through the Mi'kmaq Grand Council. The land of Mi'kma'ki was and still is divided into seven districts, from Gaspé in the north to Unamagi on Cape Breton Island. And the area where we are now, as I understand, was part of different districts at different times. Borders changed, like they always did in many societies, but it was part of the Sigamekatik Wild Potato Area district, which sort of relates to the word Shubenacadie in modern times, or Eskigawak, Skin Dressers Territory. We do small studies of aspects of the Mi'kmaq language and learn about how Mi'kmaq place names are descriptive compared to English place names, some of which are named after unrelated places in the old country or after kings and queens, for example. So when you treat the history of Mi'kmaq society as a story unto itself, rather than as a prologue to what was considered the real history, then you create a completely different narrative from the one many of us were taught in school. And that idea, by the way, if you've seen the Nigerian author Chimamanda Adichie, she has a talk online that many people have seen called The Danger of a Single Story, and that idea is present in there as well. So we then do get into the story of European contact, of course, or more accurately, the beginning of colonialism. And as you might have learned in your own history class, it started in this region in a serious way with the French, Samuel de Champlain at the beginning of the 1600s in Port Royal. And it seems that the French presence in this part of the world was relatively peaceful by colonial standards. There were some major differences between the French and the Mi'kmaq, of course, not least among them the French's extremely strange notion that they or any human could own tracts of land. In the Mi'kmaq worldview, this is as strange as owning a river or a piece of the sky. But overall, the relationship was not one of overt hostility for the most part, and there are many stories of the Mi'kmaq's good relation with French Acadians. The same couldn't be said for the British. In the colonial wars in the 17th and 18th centuries, the British and French fought for dominance over the fur trade in North America for decades, and as such, the British were more often than not enemies of the Mi'kmaq nation here in Mi'kma'ki. And it's as a result of these wars, or I should say, because of these wars, that the Mi'kmaq, along with other indigenous nations, began to sign treaties with the British. Now, when most people think about treaty rights today, as was mentioned before, there's something they associate with Aboriginal people. And many people are familiar with treaty rights to hunt and fish, for example, in the context of the Marshall Decision in 1999, or the fishing dispute in Eskenobinich in Burchells in New Brunswick. But when we think about treaties and treaty history, we have to ask ourselves, what is a treaty? And of course, the answer is that a treaty is an agreement, usually relating to peace or commerce, between two nations. The treaties signed between the British and the Mi'kmaq in the 1700s were peace and friendship treaties. They were intended to end hostilities, although that didn't always last very long. Now, there's two things that I think folks should take away about these treaties. One is that a treaty is something that's signed between nations. And so the fact that the British signed these treaties with the Mi'kmaq means that they were recognizing the Mi'kmaq sovereignty in this land. You don't sign a treaty with a nation if you don't acknowledge that that nation exists. The second thing is that the treaties that were signed were not cession treaties. And that's cession written with a C, as in the verb to cede. In other words, in signing these treaties, the Mi'kmaq did not give up their sovereignty over this land. And that's why sometimes, more and more events in this part of the world these days, you'll hear about living on unceded Mi'kmaq territory. The land we live on was never formally surrendered or negotiated away from the Mi'kmaq to the British. And this isn't a fringe historical position, by the way. You can find this information quite easily on the Government of Canada's website. And it's a bit different as well, we should mention, from different parts of Canada. Northern Ontario, Western Canada, for example, which have numbered treaties, which were signed more than 100 years after the Peace and Friendship Treaties, which are a different story. So what was in the treaties here? Well, at their simplest, they allowed for the two nations to cease hostilities and to share the land and its bounty together in peace. Although I probably don't need to tell you that that's not exactly what happened. The British kept expanding their settlements and building new ones, and a few decades in the 1780s, a group of 50,000 British colonists, known as, who came in the 1780s? Come on, I'm a teacher, I need some participation. The Loyalists came north from the newly independent United States of America and occupied the land of what we now know as Nova Scotia and New Brunswick. So if you can imagine an influx of 50,000 people into this part of the world today, you can imagine that it was a bit chaotic back then too, and respecting Mi'kmaq treaty rights to hunt and fish was not a priority for the colonial officials at the time, and to live on the land as a sovereign nation. So this was the beginning of a period that I've heard referred to as treaty denial, which is the time that colonial officials communally forgot that they had treaty obligations to Aboriginal people. It's at this time that people began to be forced onto smaller and smaller pieces of land, denied access to resources that allowed them to survive, and were eventually forced into residential schools. From the settler perspective, the treaties were mostly out of sight and out of mind for 100 to 250 years, and it's only relatively recently that courts and to some degree provincial and federal governments started to recognize Indigenous people's inherent rights to the lands and legal rights under the treaties. But non-Aboriginal Canadians shouldn't just be upset about disrespect of treaties because it's a nice thing to do for Aboriginal people. We should be upset because it's our treaty too. Those of us who are non-Aboriginal and live on this land have received great benefit from these treaties. We live in a land which most people think of as ours, which a government that we still feel we control, despite Stephen Harper's efforts. Under a justice and education system that we created here. Most people here have some sense of belonging to the place that they live. Non-Aboriginal people speak their traditional languages, observe their own traditions, and profit from resources, and have set up a capitalist society which generated great wealth. None of this would have been possible without the agreements made with Mi'kmaq and other Aboriginal people in the 1700s. So it's our responsibility as treaty signatories who have gained from these agreements to figure out how to repair that broken treaty relationship. Voila.
So I want to acknowledge that an honored elder, Billy Lewis, is here. What we thought we would do, if that's all right with you, is to have you do our closing. Is that all right? Okay. So, welcome, Billy. So the next person I want to introduce is Naiomi Metallic. She is an associate lawyer at Burchells LLP. I'm not sure I know what that means. In Halifax. Originally from the Listuguj Mi’kmaq First Nation on the Gaspé Coast of Québec, Naiomi was the first Mi’kmaq person to clerk at the Supreme Court of Canada. She is a member of her firm's Aboriginal and Litigation Practice Groups. She is also a member of the Dalhousie Board of Governors, as well as a commissioner with the Nova Scotia Legal Aid Commission. Please welcome again Naiomi Metallic.
Thank you. All right. Okay. So we got some. We were thinking of your list of other ones. We've got colonial. colonialism, displacement, residential schools, systemic racism and stereotyping that continues, the Indian Act, question mark, reserves, question mark. Some people would say that it's the modern chief and council system, question mark. And then when you put these questions to people, they will often say, it's just so complex. How can we address this? It's just so hard. And some people will say, oh, the problem is special rights and different treatment for First Nations people. And some people will say that, oh, the problem is corruption on reserves and reserve government. Well, I'm going to talk about two problems that are not talked about nearly enough, which I think are key. They didn't create these problems, but they're certainly helping exacerbate them, and they're not helping them improve. And they're the two following. Inadequate funding of First Nations programs and services on reserve, and government neglect. And by that I mean lack of effective legal frameworks on reserve. And I'll talk more about that. Cindy Blackstock had a great quote at a presentation. I heard her present that about her case, which is about there being too many First Nations children in foster care and permanent care across Canada. And she's bringing a human rights complaint against Canada on that basis, as well as the AFN. And great quote that kind of sums it up is, discrimination is when a government thinks you're not worth the money. That seems to be a big issue with First Nations people. I don't have much time to get into the situation on First Nations reserve, but there are about 600 First Nations communities in Canada. We have an on-reserve population of over 300,000 people. The federal government has control, legislative control or jurisdiction under our Constitution Act, which has been primarily expressed through the Indian Act since 1867 to the present. But a point I want to make about the Indian Act, not well known, is that outside of the Indian Act, there's only a few handful of specific laws on First Nations issues, and they primarily deal with land, money, and taxation. And then within the Indian Act itself, people often say it's a cradle-to-grave legislation. And in some respects, that's true, because there's provisions in there about wills and estates and about some things. But in fact, there's a lot that's missing from the Indian Act if it was, in fact, to be a complete code about governing a people on reserve or in a community. It really only covers kind of six discrete areas, including band membership, how collective interest on reserve with respect to reserve land is dealt with, wills and estates, taxation exemption from seizure provisions, election of band councils, and bylaws on reserve. But aside from that, notably absent are in federal laws about First Nations are anything about essential services on reserve. By that I mean social welfare, child care, health, education, policing, emergency services, housing, etc. In every single province and territory in this country, you will find legislation on all of those things that sets out what the rates are and the standards should be and all sorts of things. And it goes to a government who debates it, who talks about policy with respect to how should we be addressing these social needs. Is that happening with respect to services on reserve? No. Canada has never legislated in this area, though it could. It chooses not to. It says it does it out of the goodness of its heart, but it doesn't need to legislate. For their part, the provinces could, arguably, there's a jurisdictional constitutional argument about the provinces' extension of laws. For the sake of argument, they can, but they usually don't, because that would entail the expenditure of resources. So they usually choose not to as well. There is, to a certain extent, provinces will apply their legislation on reserve. For example, child welfare legislation. But often what we see is that they're extending the burdens of that legislation.
Naiomi, it's coercive legislation. You're out to lunch. It's coercion. It's not even coercion. It's wrong. It's wrong.
We can talk after.
Excuse me. It's important to be respectful of the speakers. Excuse me. We'll have respect for the speakers here. You are not welcome to behave this way. Thank you.
What's all about legitimate authority? You're up to lunch, Naomi.
Hey! We'll have lunch sometime. But not right now. I'm going to continue my presentation, which is to say that sometimes provincial legislation, the burdens are applied to First Nations as opposed to the benefits. So province will extend the protection mechanisms of their child welfare legislation, but not the equal amount of the equal services. So that is a massive problem. So this is basically my depiction of the essential services issue on reserve. It's basically a game of hot potato. Could First Nations address the issue independently? I think they do have the jurisdiction to pass their own laws, especially with some changes recently to the bylaw powers under the Indian Act. But it's taking a very long time also to negotiate self-government agreements in this country. And even if we did right now have the jurisdiction to do so, there's still this issue about lack of resources and infrastructure to effectively implement such laws. So at this very moment in time, we kind of need the provinces and the Canada to actually work with us in order to make this happen. So, you know, the answer to this is not really, not right now. Okay, next point I want to make is the status quo on reserve is that there really is no law about, as I said, services on reserve. The only law that can be linked to it is Section 4 of the Department of Indian Affairs and Northern Development Act, which gives Indian Affairs the jurisdiction over Indian Affairs. That is it in terms of essential services. Not a big long set of legislation, but that's it. Instead, the feds fund and regulate essential services on reserve through a combination of Treasury Board directives, policies, and funding agreements. They say that their standard is to provide comparable services, but this is open to a lot of interpretation. When you don't have a law and you just have a policy, it allows a lot of room for wiggling. And that's kind of what we see. This particular government has really wiggled a lot from what previous governments have interpreted what their policies say they have to do. And also, one of the things that the governments have always followed is that they just say, well, we'll just apply with our policies, we'll just apply similar rules to what the provinces provide. But that's really problematic as well, because it's more and more we're finding that those rules are not culturally appropriate for circumstances on reserve. Usually there's no consultation with First Nations about provincial policies, and in many cases, especially the child welfare, for example, Cindy Blackstock writes very well just about how inappropriate applying provincial child welfare legislation is and how it is really forcefully harming our communities. Okay, finally, inadequate funding is another huge issue paired with this lack of law. That there's been a 2% federal spending cap since 1996. This meant funding for First Nations has not kept pace with inflation or birth rates. This has translated into a significant decrease in bands' essential services budgets over the years. The feds say that the services that they're trying to provide are providing through their funding are comparable to programs off reserve, but First Nations have long argued that they're really not comparable. And we have several cases right now before the Canadian Human Rights Commission or Tribunal that are arguing just that they are not comparable, that they're getting lesser services, including Cindy Blackstock's child welfare case, there's one on special education funding, there's one on policing, and several reports of the Auditor General of Canada since 1994, one on social assistance, education, child welfare, emergency management, policing services, they all say the same thing. The Department of Aboriginal Affairs of Canada does not know that its services are comparable or not, and it's never studied this, and it doesn't care. Well, that the Auditor General doesn't go that far, but that's basically my interpretation of that. Right, so the problem here is that in addition to all the lack of funding and no law, we get this kind of situation where, like I say, government staff can kind of change their interpretation of things. There's no oversight by anyone in terms of what standards are being provided. And so it can lead to some harmful situations. I sometimes compare the situation on reserves to hula hoops and donuts. So, for example, to get a little technical, the donuts represent what I would say would be a healthy sort of mix of law. The donuts are these nice doughy bits of law that surround exercises of discretion. And so that's how the laws normally work. There's some law and there's some discretion in the middle. We don't have that at all. What we have more is like a giant hula hoop that's large and flimsy and plastic, and there's not much to contain it. And so, to me, that sort of is a great analogy for the system on reserve. And again, going back to the Auditor General, she has repeatedly stated in her reports that it is a massive problem, that there is no legislative or regulatory framework. There's confusion about these programs, they're not funded adequately. It undermines parliamentary control, does not provide an instrument for parliament to hold a department accountable. Services are often not comparable. And I think most importantly, the last quote there, the structural impediments severely limit the delivery of public services to First Nations communities and hinder improvements in living conditions on reserve. I mean, despite all the issues of colonialism and residential schools, I mean, that's, and the poverty, I mean, this is just exacerbating it. It's not helping things improve whatsoever. And so I think that's it's a real, real problem. And I just said that point. So the solution, I guess to me, it's really one of two things. It's either give a crap, care, the Canada and the provinces have to care enough to try to fix this problem with First Nations. And when I say Canada and the provinces, yes, I'm talking about governments, but who controls governments, or who arguably controls governments? I mean, we don't really seem to have a democratic system very much these days, but, you know, really we should be the ones pushing our leaders to actually talk about these issues and know something about these issues. How little have you heard in this election campaign about Indigenous issues? Virtually nothing. Or the other solution, which I'm more and more coming to be a proponent of, is or just get out of the way. If you're not going to fix it, then just recognize self-government jurisdiction, ensure there's appropriate funding, and get the heck out of the way, because I'm pretty sure First Nations know what's best for their communities. So I just leave on the same question that I posed at the beginning, is do our peace and friendship agreements entail mutual obligations to care for each other's well-being? Thank you.
Thank you, Naomi. He does that. Very practiced. Okay. Now we're going to hear from Dr. Afua Cooper. She's the James Robinson Johnson Chair in the Black Canadian Studies. Her research interests are African Canadian studies, in particular the period of enslavement and emancipation in the 18th and 19th century Canada and Black Atlantic. African Nova Scotian history, political consciousness, community building, and culture. Slavery's aftermath, and Black Youth Studies. She's founded the Black Canadian Studies Association, which she currently chairs. Thank you very much for being here.
First Nations people, and also the term that some Black communities in Nova Scotia use, indigenous Black communities or indigenous African Nova Scotians. So I thought, as I thought through this, I thought I would maybe answer the question, are Black people settlers? Answer it by saying no, Black people are not settlers. Not in the sense that we understand the word to be, not in the sense that it's talked about earlier on, not in the sense of when treaties are made, say between Mi'kmaq First Nations and European communities or leaders, it did not, these treaties did not have African Canadian, and I'll use the term Canadian because I'm sort of looking all across the country, African Canadian people in mind. They were not part of these treaty makings historically. In contemporary times, I would say maybe blacks are ambiguous settlers, because in contemporary times, with migrations from, say, different places in Africa and the Caribbean and the United States, over the South America too, over the course of, say, the past 50 years, and when people come into Canada and take the oath of allegiance to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, that is becoming Canadian citizens, then all these people, have a right or should learn about the history, should know about these treaties, but unfortunately they're not, and I'll hold that thought for a while, because the thing is, very few people in Canada actually know what's in these treaties, actually are taught what's in these treaties, actually are taught any kind of Aboriginal studies or Aboriginal histories when you go to school, from primary school straight through to universities, that knowledge is not there. Well, I'm saying, once people take this oath of citizenship, because the treaties were signed between sovereign nations, whether these sovereign nations were First Nations or the sovereign nation or empire, colonial entity that was Britain or France, right? So settlers historically know, in contemporary times perhaps, ambiguous settlers. And I wanted to show this slide because in researching black history, and it's not the earliest one that speaks to the black presence, of course, we know someone, Ben mentioned Champlain, coming and Sir Dumont and all those people, and we know they had in their entourage blacks who worked, primarily men, who worked as translators and linguists and so on. Matthew da Costa is of course very famous because he was with exploring parties here in Nova Scotia, and he spoke French and Dutch and several Aboriginal languages. So how did Matthew da Costa, who is described as a Portuguese African, how did he know these Aboriginal languages? He must have been here way before 1604, 1608, when he made it into the historical records. So it's interesting that the first document we have of black people in these parts of the world, in Nova Scotia, is of a free people. Later on, as the century matured, you find the black people as enslaved people. Whether they were enslaved by the Acadians, and yes, the Acadians had held enslaved Africans, and later on, when the Acadians were displaced and deported, and the New England planters came up to occupy the Acadian lands, the New England planters, of course, brought hundreds of African American enslaved people to Nova Scotia, and they continued in servitude. When Cornwallis came in 1749, we know he had enslaved people in his party. This is 1751, this ad, 2 years after the so-called founding of Halifax. We have just arrived from Halifax and to be sold 10 strong-hearted Negro men, and their traders or tradesmen, artisans, caulkers, carpenters, sailmakers, rope makers, any person wishing to purchase, may inquire of Benjamin Hallowell of Boston. So one surmises that they were in Halifax doing the building, doing the work of, it's 2 years after Cornwallis, the thing that enslaved people do, you know, building houses, chopping down the trees, their caulkers. They worked in the maritime trade, obviously. And the next slide, so this is 1751 in Boston Post, 1752, a year later, the Halifax Gazette. And we know, just imported and to be sold at sold by Joshua Mauger, or Major, as my friend from New Brunswick told me, it's called, there's a Majorville in New Brunswick, at Major Lockman's store in Halifax, several Negro slaves, namely a very likely Negro wench of 35 years of age, Creole-born, brought up in a gentleman's family, and capable of doing all sorts of work, such as needlework, in the best manner, washing, ironing, cookery, and every other thing that can be expected from such a slave. Also, two Negro boys of about 12 or 13 years old, healthy, strong, well-shaped, understand some English, which makes me think that they were recent imports from Africa or from another non-English colony, from Cuba or Martinique, let's say. Likewise, two healthy Negro slaves of about 18 years of age, of agreeable temper, fit for any kind of business, healthy Negro man of about 30 years of age. 1752, pretty early, imported by Joshua Major, who was a big wig here in Halifax, big in the government, big trader. When Louis Bird fell, he came to Halifax, owned many ships, engaged in colonial trade with the West Indies. I'm almost certain that he imported these slaves from Barbados to be sold on the slave market here in Halifax. So whether it's Acadian period, whether it's this period of settlement with Cornwallis, and whether it's the loyalists that Ben talked about, we know the free black loyalists came in and also the enslaved loyalists. Well, maybe we can't call them loyalists because they were enslaved, but the enslaved Africans who were owned by white loyalists. And then later on, War of 1812, refugees. And we don't have time to talk about, you know, why, but let's just say these people, especially the free black loyalists and the War of 1812 people, fought on the side of the British in various colonial wars. They were runaway slaves. Now, they were promised, made all these promises, which, as we know, were never fulfilled. And that is why in 1792, 12 or 1300 of the free black loyalists left from right here, Halifax Harbor, January 1792, and sailed to Freetown, West Africa, Sierra Leone, for a better life, because they were reduced to peonage and to slavery and all kinds of bad things. So they said, you know, we're out of here, and they left, several, you know, many of their fellows here. So these people could not have been settlers. I'm gonna skip to the future and said, yes, if black communities today are suing the British government or have the idea to sue the British government or whomever for broken promises, including land that were never given to the let's say the loyalists, then black communities know that they must go to the Mi'kmaq community and discuss these matters. And I know people are doing that. And I, you know, both things, suing the British government and knowing that the step that they must take is to go to the First Nation communities in this province and other provinces. So that's one thing. But even after Confederation, even after 1867, when Canada became, you know, this thing, when Canada became Canada, black people were ousted from the body politic. If you're looking at the nation state, which a colonial state, a settler state, it was not a state that that saw black people as, you know, a meaningful or an important segment of the nation state, right? So for 100 years, from Confederation 1867 to 1967, in terms of its policies as a white settler colonial state, Canada was a white-only country for immigrants. What does that say for the people, the black people who had been here historically, or for the black people who wanted to come from Africa and the Caribbean? What does that say? When, like Australia, you had only a white entry immigration policy. So I will just, maybe in the question, we can talk about why some black communities call themselves indigenous black communities. I would say that in response to some of the issues, blacks were not a nation per se. So if we're talking about signing treaties, blacks were not a nation. In these time periods, black people were a subjugated people. They were an enslaved people. And even when they were free, they did not have the clout or the power to be part of these treaties. So they were not signatories of these treaties. I want to end by saying, as today, up to this point, Black communities in Canada, across Canada, have lodged several complaints at the human rights complaints at the United Nations. As we speak in this month of October, with the United Nations Human Rights Commission's meeting in Geneva, there is a document that's been taken by people from the African Canadian Legal Clinic to Geneva to lodge a complaint against the Canadian government for discriminatory practices against African Canadian communities, the over-incarceration in prison, the high dropout rate from high school, especially the children being drafted into foster care. This document is going to the United Nations this month. So therefore, our position in Canada is not one of a settler position, because Blacks still are relatively powerless and continue to be ousted out of the body politic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cooper. I would like to introduce our last speaker for the evening, Sharon Pictou. She is the former chief of the Bear River First Nation, member of the Coordinating Committee of the World Forum of Fisher Peoples, associate staff with the Bay of Fundy Marine Resources Center, and interdisciplinary PhD candidate at Dalhousie University. Please welcome Sharon Pictou.
Stand, but I think I'll try to do this sitting here. And some of you that have heard me before, I'm getting older, I'm getting forgetful, and so I write and I may read and interject as best as I possibly can. First of all, I want to extend my deep appreciation and thanks to everyone, especially Solidarity Halifax, for all the planning. Very important event, and to the Halifax Library for hosting it. And I also want to thank the drummers and the singers. That was that's and of course, it's a great honor to have been asked to be a part of this panel along with Naiomi Metallic, Ben Seashell. I asked him, how do you pronounce your name? And Dr. Cooper. I say this is a very important event because it is an event that challenges us to think outside of the official or institutional formations of reconciliatory processes, residential school apologies, and treaty negotiations that many Indigenous intellectuals have critiqued as processes that serve to only to perpetuate colonialism in contemporary capitalist forms. The increase in protest and movements of resistance of the I Don't Know More movement and the ongoing protest against extraction industries have revealed just how strong the existence of colonial capitalism is. On the other hand, and more critically, this increased resistance also marks alternative forms of relationships and collaborations between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people that are different from the formal ones being hammered out behind bureaucratic closed doors in the disguise of reconciliation and treaty recognition. To borrow Rion's philosophers, and those of you who know me, this will be an old tune, but to borrow Rion's philosopher James Tully's term at the University of Victoria, I refer to these alliances for resistance and social change as the small T treaty partnerships or relations. This is because these alliances are outside and often in resistance to official structures for land claims and treaty negotiations in which Indigenous worldviews become co-opted or not considered at all, especially if they are in conflict with the neoliberal order of the extractive industry and marketplace. So I guess Naiomi was talking about the social, and I'm going back to the land. That's the ongoing challenge for alliances or small T treaty partnerships will be the question of how do we as treaty partners prevent perpetuating this colonialism? In other words, what would decolonization or decolonizing work look like? As the work of many Indigenous scholars, activists, and artists have argued, decolonization must begin with an honest examination and dialogue about our relationship with the land. This is because lands are fundamental to the operation of colonial capitalism and is supported by its legal form as property rights. Therefore, decolonization involves decolonizing not only our interhuman relationships, but what Eve Tuck and Marcia McKenzie in their new book called Place and Research refers to as the relations of interspecies, the natural world. They further point out how the imposition of colonial legal forms of property rights not only means the continued erasure of Indigenous people from history and physically removing them from their ancestral homelands, but also how immigrants have become the new form of containment of slave labor in the property to work the land. There is a fundamental difference between immigrants and settlers, because settlers came here with the intent of imposing their laws on this land. Immigrants come with the intention of integrating in too. Therefore, fundamental to capitalist colonialism is ongoing racism. And as we well know, any alternative conceptualizations of land that do not conform to capitalist colonialism are cast as not relevant and as potential security risks. Every social movement and activist, especially if they are activists of color in Canada, have been cast in this light. But we well know the security risk has nothing to do with protecting human relations, but only for the protection of property rights and their profitability potential. And if extractive industries are at the basis for treaty implementation, our relations to the lands will continue to be structured as property in the disguise of treaty recognition and economic development. And we have seen this with the omnibus bills passed that started the Idle No More movement. The domination of property diminishes the potential of interspecies relationality inherent in Indigenous worldviews, which is why our relations to land must continue to be at the heart of our ongoing struggles as treaty partners. Unfortunately, this struggle is not only with non-Indigenous people, but also with ourselves as Indigenous peoples, as long as we continue to internalize our own colonialism, where property rights are at the expense of the rights of humans and other relational species, and especially if that's against the right to freedom. Interpretations of land play out in the treaties. For Indigenous people, land is not a thing, but entails food harvesting practices as opposed to just profit making, and the treaties are viewed as living and intergenerational. For example, most of the Peace and Friendship Treaties reference the freedom to hunt and fish, and to quote the 1725-26 treaties, for myself and in my behalf of my tribe, my heirs and their heirs forever. And there's a similar clause in the 1752 treaty. However, the property notion is also explicit in the 1725-26 treaty with the clause that His Majesty's subjects, the English, shall and may peacefully and quietly enter upon and improve and forever enjoy all the singular and singular that individual, their rights of God and former settlements, properties, and possessions. These two opposing views of treaty rights continue to be in conflict in 2015 because the modern construct of treaty negotiations becomes about extractive industries, property rights, as opposed to the Indigenous interrelational and living conception of the treaty. This is the latter concept that has to become at the heart of our treaty relationship and partnership to transform and disrupt neoliberal forms of colonialism. And I want to quote this fantastic book that's put together by Indigenous and non-Indigenous artists and scholars, The Land We Are. When we as settlers misunderstand treaties as the lawful means by which Indigenous peoples gave up land for settlement and exploitative development, we legitimize that this is in fact a history of theft and possession. And the failure to uphold historical agreements governing peaceful interactions between sovereign political bodies and their citizens. And against the nation-to-nation model, the story of inclusion, which is another word for assimilation, and of accommodation has become the official story that gets told about our relation to one another and how reconciliation might work. This is a continuation of colonial violence as well as a danger violation of our own capacity to imagine and enact something different, unquote. And I also left out a little part that I received some sad news about a suicide today. But many of the suicides, and particularly in the north, and there was a comparison done of three countries, these are from the generation that's just one removed generation from their parents who lived on the land. One positive step to treaty relationship building was made on Treaty Day here in Halifax with the Nova Scotia Chiefs and the Nova Scotia government announcement of a treaty education project. And I want to point out, Jaime Batiste is here, and he is the man, if any teacher wants to find out, he will be developing that treaty education project. Jaime, please stand up. Chief Leroy Denny from Eskazoni was quoted as saying, "Together the Mi'kmaq and the province have begun to plant the seeds of a just and responsibility so that future generations will understand our shared history and shared responsibility in Nova Scotia." However, there has to be room to critically hammer out what does responsibility means, and I contend that our shared responsibility must also involve the present and related acts of remembering our presence, our histories, and our reciprocal relations to the land, whether it be through storytelling, art forms, and events such as this one, in order to create spaces for imagining alternatives. Tucker and Mackenzie point out how the land has a way of decolonizing itself, as we are witnessing with the impacts of climate change and other ways the earth is talking back to us. This, if anything, should compel us to uptake relational understandings of the land as part of our mutual responsibility to ensure they become the premise for ongoing nation-to-nation treaty relations. And in closing, I just want to mention that also coinciding on Treaty Day, there's a fabulous interactive atlas of Nova Scotia done by the Gorse Brook Research Institute at St. Mary's University. You can go on there, and they have all the place names and the pronunciation in Mi'kmaq, and there's some fabulous clips of elders being interviewed. And I just wanted to mention that. And I have to close with two very dear allies that I have been working with for a number of years is Anne Bishop's book, Becoming an Ally, Breaking the Cycle of Oppression. This is the third edition. It's just out. How to work through those difficult, uncomfortable relations that we must work through in order to decolonize. And of course, a long-term colleague, Arthur Bull, who I discovered after 6 years working with him on fishery issues, is also a poet. And this is called Woodlot. And it's a deep, meditative piece of poetry, or pieces of poetry, that reflect on his role as a settler in Nova Scotia, Willowland, and Mississippi. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry. So the next thing we're going to do is to have an unfortunately brief, but brief Q&A session. But before I do that, I just want to introduce the artwork that is over there of some young artists, Indigenous artists, and I would like them to stand. So please stand, please. And Taylor, who had to leave momentarily, is also one of those artists, as is Sebastian Labelle, who's in back. And later on, we want to honor our guests here with gifts, which actually are, three of them are original small paintings by Aiden that we commissioned to do this for tonight. So. And as well the treaty cards, which will be explained later after the Q&A by Ben Seychelle, was also designed by Aiden, who worked with us tirelessly through the whole process. So, if someone would volunteer to come and take one of these microphones, somebody, anybody could volunteer to take one of these microphones. Maybe somebody from, all right, great. We have a volunteer who's going to take a microphone. I don't know where they've all gone. Did you put them in your bag, Ben? Okay. He's a musician. You never know what they're doing. What they're going to pull. All right, so we want to give preference, if possible, to speakers who do not usually get the day. And we like to invite people to focus, if possible, on asking questions of the guests that we have here today. So we have about probably 15 to 20 minutes for this. So is there a... No, we're actually not nearly as bad as I thought we were. All right. So, did you want to speak first, please?
My concern has to do primarily with the misinformation on Mi'kmaq that is just running rampant these days there, especially with the educational thing. I have a question, but I'd like to point out first that Mi'kmaq traditional government was never a grand council. That's a relatively new thing historically and never came into being until the late 1800s. And the first Grand Chief of all Mi'kmaq was not a member to, it was Gabriel Sillaboy in 1919. The question I'd like to ask you is, within your course, are you teaching things like medicine wheel, dream catcher, etc.?
I'm not... Personally, the medicine wheel, I think you're referring to some controversy about the provenance of the medicine wheel, and I think the short answer, like, to answer some of your questions, I thank you for pointing some of those things out, and just like in any history, there are different sources that we draw from, so sometimes I might have taught something, and then we'll find another source that contradicts it later on, so... In terms of the Grand Council, you know, I'm always learning and I'm always finding different things. And I found some. I was given some source material that talks about the Mi'kmaq Grand Council's traditional governance. So thank you, and I'll look into those kind of things.
I will point out that early Mi'kmaq government was kind of unique. It was, you know, community consensus, which is democracy, I would say, in its purest form. But the reason I asked on the other question there is every time I turn around I see like the pan-Indian influence. For example, medicine wheel, there's not even words in the Mi'kmaq language for it. You know, same with dream catcher. So that is a concern for a lot of us.
First of all, I'm Sherry Pinto, and I'm from Elsecook, and I'm from one of the traditional territories in southwest Nova Scotia. And yes, there is some debate of when the Grand Council come into being, and it was a strategic move, and I respect that, and I respect the agency of my people, and I've been told, and it's been verified by other Grand Council members, that yes, indeed, in Southwest Nova Scotia, where Member 2 was where the Grand Council used to meet prior to being driven out by the English. And I just wanted to clarify that. So there's different perspectives on history. And the other issue that you raise about Pan-American Indianism, there's a danger of what is authentic, because the Mi'kmaq people, the Maliseet people, the Passamaquoddy people have had the longest years of colonialism. We've had over 500 years. And forgive us if we don't get it right, but at least we brought those ceremonies back in the last 25, 30 years that were non-existent in my childhood.
Are there any more? We have two more questions or comments?
Hello? I'm originally from British Columbia, Morristown, B.C. I'm Chief Gurki Mama from the Wolf Clan, Cherry Nation. I'm a residential school survivor, and I moved here from B.C. because my husband was not well. And the reason why we left is because of the federal and the provincial government and our health benefits. I want to know why weren't we informed about this treaty that was going on when just 5 years ago we had lost our boy to the government, and they took him away because I suffer from PTSD and so does my husband. What can you do for us, since he's a Mi'kmaq maritimer, retired journeyman carpenter? How can you help us? That's my question.
Hi, my name is Morty Gugu. I'm the regional chief for the Assembly of First Nations. I represent Nova Scotia and Newfoundland. I myself had the opportunity to be chief of my community in Wagobah First Nation, Waikaguma, for 19 years, and it's my second term being regional chief. I think Treaty Day was set up in 1986 by Donald Marshall Sr., you know, our grand chief, late grand chief, to start the whole process of what we're really trying to do now is reconciliation. He wanted the province to kind of remember that we do have treaties and that we should gather in a ceremony to remind everybody and educate everybody on Treaty Day. So that's where our Treaty Day started. I have a chance to go across the country and see how many different things happen. And for everybody to understand, I guess, the whole year there's going to be reconciliation going on. Justice St. Clair said it can't be the federal government or corporations, you know, that's going to reconcile everything. And we can't have the chiefs just pounding their fists and, you know, getting our inquiry that we're looking for. All of that stuff is not going to get to one stage of reconciliation. It's collectively having these sessions where people, non-Native people, actually get to sit down and listen to a lot of our issues, you know? A lot of people, and I really wish that they had the opportunity to show the video there, Aboriginal Justice for All really covers it so good. A lot of people say, why don't you people just get over it? Their treaties, get, you know? Why are they arguing about it again? This video here covers it really, really good anyway. By reconciliation, Canada had a bad past. Could you imagine for a second, just closing your eyes for 1 second, that you're home with your kids, and the next thing you know, there's somebody shows up.
Can you answer my question?
Yes. No. And then their kids are taken away from you.
There's only a brief amount of time for questions, so if you could sum it up a bit, that would be great.
All right, basically, I'm not sure if the question it was more on social programming or recognition that you were asked before, but if there's things, I'd be more than happy to talk to you and see what we can do at Treaty Days in recognition for us and being Mi'kmaq. Blood.
Thank you. One of the important things that we're trying to do tonight is to put forward the point of view that there is no reconciliation without justice, and that there might have been a bad, bad past, but there's also a bad, bad present. And those are some of the issues that we're trying to bring forward to.
Okay, we had another question over here. I think we have time for one more.
To me personally, it is actually something I take back to my son, and we have a mixed heritage, being French and Mi'kmaq, also a little Irish in there as well. To answer someone's question earlier about the education system, my son did receive his first medicine bag when he graduated high school, so it is coming, so there's hope for that. My question in particular was about sort of the land issues that Dr. and Naiomi have both mentioned. I noticed in the history itself, some of the most prime locations were ripped away, both for the African Canadian people that had been given the land to settle on, and also for the Mi'kmaq people. In order to sort of, I guess, take away that and give something back, where does one start? What does that even look like? I mean, I know we have a whole bunch of social and economical association with that as well, but what would that even look like?
So I think one thing that would be good to look at as a model, and which the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action actually say, is look to the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, which includes 46 articles that is fairly comprehensive about what Indigenous people have a right to. And when it comes to lands that were taken, they should have a fair process to have that heard. They should be entitled to have the return of lands of equal value. And so there's actually some really great standards in the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. And if you even just plug it into your computer, you can go and read it, and it's not that long, and it's a great document. In fact, I prefer now to looking at case law under our Section 35 or our Constitution, because those cases that you have to prove this stuff about history. But the UN Declaration really is just about, as Indigenous people, these are the rights that the original people have just by virtue of being the original people. And I think that is so much more compelling than some of the tests that have developed under older case law. Maybe Dr. Cooper?
Thank you. I am, thinking through this construct that we call North America or Central America or South America or the Caribbean, this entire Americas as we understand it today, is in our consciousness and in terms of concept, came about because of this invasion, European invasion, and the theft of Aboriginal territories in the entire Americas, from Canada to Argentina. Concomitant with that was the passage of millions of people from Africa, and of course, enslavement of Aboriginal people was tried, and then later on, indentureship of Irish and English and Welsh and so forth, and that kind of faded away. But it was African labor that became the predominant labor form in these continents for 400 years, right? So we're looking at the theft of bodies, the theft of labor, and the theft of these things over generations. You're counting 400 years, right? What does one do? How does one begin to grapple with that, with these two things? Jumping ahead, thinking through this, knowledge of African Canadians, say by First Nation communities, and knowledge of First Nation communities, say by African Canadians, is not really there. Our understanding of each other has been mediated through the lens of settler society, through the lens of white society. We don't read about each other in the history books, right? Sometimes there are all these stereotypes that one imbibes based on what one learns through the colonial text. At the same time, the whole issue of reparations within the Americas, from Canada to Argentina, is a live issue. Some of you may know that last week the British Prime Minister visited Jamaica, and as soon as he got off the flight, the reparationist or reparationers met him and said, "We want reparations for 300 years of slavery and colonial rule." And he dismissed that. He said, "You know, forget that. That's not going to happen." As we speak, at the University of the West Indies, reparation experts are meeting. The CARICOM nations, the 14-member CARICOM nations, what can be done, is suing Great Britain, or Britain, for years of not only slavery, but colonial genocide of indigenous people and of African people. So this is happening. Led by people like Peter Rebecca. So if people like David Cameron, Prime Minister of the UK, is saying forget that, in fact he said forget it, it's in the past, we need to move on. And then what Cameron has to do, and others of his ilk, Francois Hollande, etc., is to remove the 50 million of us in North America, the 50 million of us in Brazil, all the mixed bloods, whether they're mixed with First Nations people or whites, all the people who have been described as black, remove all of us from the Caribbean, where we were forcibly taken and had our bodies and everything stolen from us. Put us back to Africa, and in the process, rehabilitate those broken countries in Africa that they continue to loot and rob and rape. So it is multidimensional. It requires that we bring our brain power to these issues. When I look at, say, relations in Nova Scotia between blacks and Mi'kmaq community, there's been a lot of intermixing over the centuries. Some people identify one way or the other. Some people are trying to identify, recognizing the métissage or the mixed bloodness. When we look at what's happening in the United States with the Cherokees, for example, African Cherokees have been cast out of the tribe. There's a lot of issues that we need to talk about and to come to some understandings. At the same time, we cannot fall prey to the divide and rule strategy that the colonial state always imposed on us. Right? We have to be vigilant about that. Thank you.
We're getting very, very late. So is this short comment? Short.
I just said how thrilled I am to see so many people here today for this discussion. And as alluded to before, I'm the treaty education lead for Nova Scotia, just appointed on Treaty Day, really, to move treaty education forward in this province. And you're right, it is about time. But the thing is, it took time to get where we are. And a lot of people said that, it's been aligning of the stars to get the Mi'kmaq and the province on the same page. But I don't look at it that way. I see it as, just as Chief Leroy mentioned, you know, these seeds were planted a long time ago, you know, by Grand Chief Donald Marshall, by Alex Christmas, by Viola Robinson, to move us to where we are today. And they planted those seeds, so now that we're able to eat the fruit that we're able to do now. And I have a question. But I just wanted to say before I move forward that, you know, being here, listening to, you know, the discussions and listening to, you know, a non-Mi'kmaq talk about Mi'kmaq history as well as Band-Aid today, it gives me hope for the future of this. And to hear so many non-Mi'kmaq to sit down and listen respectfully and attentively, for the most part, is something I'm amazed and it gives me hope for this province that we're going to get there with the Treaty Education Initiative. It's going to take time, but reconciliation takes time. And so my question is this, is these talks were so great, is there any way of getting that on YouTube so I can share it online at the Treaty Education Nova Scotia Facebook page?
I think that's our plan. We're going to try to bring things to a close because we want people to talk to each other, and there are a couple more things that are important to us to do this evening. Pardon? Well, but there's about 250 people here, and please understand that we're going. We really are going to be closing at this time. We have to close the library. The library will put us out at 9 o'clock. There are other parts of the program that are happening tonight. So anybody who wants to come and speak to the speakers afterward, we're going to invite Doug to give the gifts to all the presenters, and we're going to invite Billy to come forward to make the closing remarks.
Don't look at the light, Billy, no! Let us talk first. Yeah, don't let her cut us off, Billy. They've been doing this for 500 years. And the same words, same things in the past year, that some parents would never let the Mi'kmaqs talk about things. They never let us talk about this.
They don't let us talk about this.
They don't represent us because they've never heard us. So don't believe them.
So what I'm going to say
and
is
that's
that
why she's trying to shut us up.
There are many divisions within the community.
We're divided against her.
There are many divisions within the community. We invited Billy Lewis to come forward earlier, and we continue to invite him forward. The discussion can continue afterwards, and after Billy comes forward, if you feel comfortable. If not, Ben will explain the treaty card proposal that Aiden has designed and that we've put together for this evening. If you don't feel comfortable, Billy, I'll ask Ben to explain the project that we have in mind.
I often get invited to do the opening for these things, but it's only because I slept in, missed the bus, and wound up here a half an hour late that I'm doing the closing. But I've done that as well. But the closing is usually when everything is not finalized, but at least there's a consensus on which direction we're going. And I think that the discussions that have happened here tonight and the presentations, each of them contribute so much that I was sitting there
with some of the knowledge I have about some of those things, and thinking of how valuable it is, and this is probably good that I'm batting last, if you will, because that gives us all a chance to stop and think about what was said. We don't have to agree, you know, like we're not going to get agreement. That never happens. The discussion itself is what's going to count from this point on, because what this was meant to do, this whole gathering, you know, as part of the planning committee, was to get us thinking about these things, about treaty, about relationships, about the land. We're doing that. We're doing that right now. And so it's more important that we carry on not only that discussion, but that we carry on listening and hearing each other. Because if we don't do that, there'll be no solution at all. And I was thinking of it in terms of what the, I don't know who he was or what have you, the young fellow at the back that stood up and first of all laid out who he was, you know, before he even asked anybody else what was going on. Personally and philosophically myself, as my friends here know, I consider myself an anarchist, and I resent that. Because what it means is we listen to each other, and we don't rely on a higher authority, whether it's colonialism, whether it's the government itself. We're in the middle of an election, for heaven's sake. And even in spite of my views, I'd rather get rid of Harper than argue the philosophy. I'm emphasizing that just literally off the top of my head, because I want each of us to sit there and think about all the different points that were raised and go back and read the books that was referred to, listen to each other, because, you know, we have a joke, a saying in our community that the Creator gave us 2 ears but only one mouth, because we're supposed to listen twice as much as we talk. We really have to take this as inspiration and not take it as a chance to tackle each other and disagree with each other. But we don't have that disagreement. I know that I have disagreements about what happened in February of 2012 when people went behind closed doors and cut a deal on my behalf. I didn't agree one bit with that stuff. And what it has to happen, it has to go back to the streets, not the suites. We've got to take control of these things ourselves. We'll have it.
Thank you, Ben. Now Ben Sichel is going to explain to us the idea behind the treaty cards for settlers.
Thanks. So just briefly, you probably received one of these when you walked in, and maybe some of you have seen before the Settler Treaty card that was put up by Briar Patch Magazine a number of years ago. Anyone see that? Show of hands. No? Okay. Getting blank stares. Oh, there's a few. It reminds me of my classroom. So these cards, the idea is a reminder for non-Indigenous people to carry with them. And we invite you, if you wish to, and we hope you would, to sign it and to read the list of treaty rights and obligations that we developed in inspiration with the Peace and Friendship Treaties and the Committee of Indigenous and Non-Indigenous Folks Together who planned this event. And the design on the front, as mentioned, was designed by Aidan Gill, and it's two canoes. And the inspiration there is from a wampum belt, I believe from the Mohawk and Six Nations territory, who had two canoes on a wampum belt, one Indigenous and one settler. And the two canoes are supposed to move along unmolested and without getting in each other's way. They're supposed to symbolize coexistence. And so this is the idea behind these settler treaty cards. On the back of the card, you'll see it says, "The holder of this card is bound by the Peace and Friendship Treaties of 1725 to 61, signed by the Mi'kmaq Nation and the British Crown. These treaties bestow rights and obligations on the descendants of its signatories, interpreted as the Mi'kmaq people and all residents of Canada." There's a correction there. It should be the residents of Mi'kmaq territory, but anyway. And then there's a leaflet is here as well that we'd invite you to use for yourself to say what will you do to fulfill your treaty obligations. And before you go tonight, we have a few minutes before we have to clear out of the library, but we've set up a photo booth. It says photo booth over on that side, but it's actually going to be wheeled in front of the black curtain. And we have a number of signs with some ideas that people can, of things that people can do to begin to uphold their side of the treaty relationship if they're a non-Indigenous person. For example, I will demand an inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women. And we invite you to be up here and to have your photo taken, and we're going to put it on social media. So this is a way we were trying to figure out to do something that wasn't just a panel discussion where you go home and feel like there's nothing that you've done or nothing you can do. We realize it's a small thing, but we also didn't want to suddenly corral people up and march you to the legislature. So we invite you to take that step if you would like to. And yeah, that's the idea behind the cards.
Dr. Cooper has asked me to just announce that the 215 McKay History Lecture, hosted by the Dalhousie History Department and James Robertson Johnson Chair in Black Canadian Studies, will be Thursday, November 5th at 7 o'clock, Teaching in the Age of Black Lives Matter, Social Media, Social Justice, and Social Change in Classrooms and Communities. And there are pamphlets here for anyone who likes. So, thank you.
Yes, thank you for coming. I wish we had more time. I could talk about this all night, but we don't. We have to be out of here by 9, and I apologize.
I have one question. I have one question.